Hey, what's up, everybody? This is Eddie FM from Los Angeles, and you are staring at the insides of a Korg Poly-61 analog synthesizer. So let's go in and take a look at this. I purchased this machine from a vintage music store in LA for $150, knowing that it doesn't work. Now, when I spoke to the people at the store, they said it did turn on, it made some sounds, and I was like, oh, I'll go check it out. Why not? Now, I really lucked out so far because there's an excellent video by this guy named Mick, and he's from Germany. So if you just look up Korg Poly-61 Repair on YouTube and his Google Plus account, spelled M-I-K, is his first name, you will find an hour and a half long video that talks about how to repair this. And it shows you kind of the different sections and everything. Initially, the people at the sales shop told me that somebody probably like spilled a drink somewhere up in here, like through this top panel and down in. Well, I don't see any kind of evidence right there that a drink was spilled. What I have seen, though, is that it looks like somebody attempted to repair it but didn't quite know what they're doing, because, like, for example, this grounding cable was not attached and they still haven't soldered it or fixed the terminal. I'll just fix the terminal, but somebody like put some bunk solder down in there and this wire was just kind of hanging free. I noticed a difference between this Korg and Mick's Korg is that it's probably, you know, as a result of this being modified for the United States type electrical system, that this does not have an extra ground cord right here, which would be attached to that terminal. But everything tested out here fine. I mean, Mick does a great job. I'm not gonna try to explain that. I'm just trying to supplement his video. You probably wanna test everything in here with a multimeter. And you know, I did, and it was so useful following his directions on that. So basically when I got the synthesizer, it was just making a solid sound when you, I'll turn it on right now and kind of show you what was going on with that. So I'm going to flip this on back here. And if I pressed like 22 on the top, you would hear just kind of a sound like that. But it wouldn't even sound as clear. But it, see, it's already playing without me even touching any kind of button, right? Nothing's going on. And none of these LEDs down here are working on the, this is the voice board, this one on the right. I learned from Mick's video that there's LEDs down here because there's six voices, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And whenever the voice is played, there's an LED that should be kind of lighting up somewhere in here, right? Well, I don't see that occurring at all on any of the voices. Another thing, after doing a lot of research about this synthesizer, is somewhat funny. I'm gonna turn this volume down for a second. Is that when Korg built this and some of their other synthesizers, they placed a rechargeable battery here because this has some digital components. Like these have computer chips in it, although it's analog. Instead of the normal pots that you would see to shape the electricity so you could create different sounds, this synthesizer uses computer chips to give you kind of a step programming. So if you want to apply filters and things like that, you do it through these chips. Now, check it out. This green thing, that's a replacement battery. Because as I was saying, Korg decided to put a rechargeable battery right there, and that would hold memory stored in the RAM. So if you programmed your synthesizer, it could remember the exact input that you had for different settings. That would allow you to kind of save your own patch. But basically what happened is, like, after about 5 or 6 years of this, this is a NiCad battery, basically. And I believe it is. I guess I didn't really look that up, but this battery would leak out onto the CPU board. And that is horrible. It looks like whoever did operate on this before that couldn't get it working, they checked everything out and they even labeled okay on certain boards. So somebody put some time and effort into it. And You know, perhaps this is a newer CPU board. I can't really tell, but it's very clean, and especially in comparison to this board, the voice board that's a little bit darker and dustier. Who knows? But they replaced the rechargeable battery, and the battery works, and that's amazing. But it's still not working, the synthesizer. So what was going wrong with it? Well, let me show you. When I got this synthesizer, like I said, I'll turn the volume up again. It's just making a solid sound right here, okay? So look, the ARP was working. That was fine. And this button on off is working fine for the most part. These two buttons and the poly mode, they work fine. The right button seems to work, but parameter, that button is not working for me. So I'm gonna have to repair that this week because I can't switch from program to parameter. And then, as you can see, I've got this set up on 22. I can change this one. And it sounds pretty badass today, to tell you the truth. But when I got this synthesizer, this LED above the frequency pot was not operating. So Mick gave me some good advice. He said, "What should I do, Mick?" And he said, just like in his video, that what I probably would restore functionality, and you can see it's functioning now. So how did I get to that area? The master clock board is not functioning. The LED wasn't working. So you knew something was wrong in this area. And I don't have an oscilloscope at home, so I'm just kind of working with a multimeter here. But look what I did. It's just like Mick suggested, there's a connector down here labeled 27 that's going from the CPU board, this board down here. See that? And it's right on the edge back here, labeled 27. You see brown wires and some white wires, and I believe some orange ones. They come out, they go around this path, and they connect up into the master clock board. And you can see the bottom of the number 27 on each of those. So basically what I do is just unplug these things and unplug this side, and then you kind of want to look down in it once you unplug it and follow Mick's advice on his video. Just look him up on YouTube. Again, it was just type in something like Korg Poly-61 repair and spell his name Mick. And the guy's great. He's brilliant. He's from Germany and his videos are hilarious, I think. So, for one reason or another. So what I did is followed his advice and I just kind of stripped all these out on the 27 one. I'm just showing you this one because it's easier to point the camera at. But I pulled all these out and then I stripped each of those cables, and luckily at Fry's Electronics in Burbank, I was able to find these connectors. And inside that harness, the wires need to be connected to it. It seemed like that was a major problem that Mick had with his, and it definitely was true for mine. These needed to be replaced. So basically, you'd stick the wire in that, crimp it, and then plug it back into the harness right there. All right, so here was the part that I was able to find. He was showing the parts he got in Germany, and these look like a more accurate fit, actually, and they had them in stock at Fry's in, the connectors aisle. So it's a company named Molex, molexkits.com. So there's Waldom Electronics on it. The pack was about $3 at Fry's, probably cheaper online. KK mini crimp terminals, and it's model number WMLX106. And you can see there are center housings, and they're 2.54 millimeters. So with that in mind, I fixed that part. And oh, see, like you can see there's some corrosion and stuff going on back there. I wonder if that's what they thought, like maybe somebody spilled a drink right there. But anyway, fix that housing, that area, and this is working. And it sounds a lot better so far, the synthesizer. But still, I'm gonna turn it up So I'm using these monitors as like a test because of the brand. Hey, it's Behringer, right? I don't want to blow out any better speakers. So maybe that's why Behringer speakers are always useful to have on hand. I don't know. Doesn't, you know, these are really good monitors, by the way. So look. Not much functionality, and for some damn reason, it's just automatically making, you know, all that works. But it's just got this note or voice on sustain. What the heck is the next problem with this? So what I'm gonna do right now is I noticed that, check this out, this connector, it doesn't matter, it still works without that. So I imagine that this is not conducting anything correctly from cable 12 all the way. And see how these wires separate out? Remember there's six voices? Some go up here, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, and 6. There's a six on. So remember the voice board. I don't feel like this is making a proper connection, and I don't have an oscilloscope. I'll check it on the multimeter and figure it out. But it looks like that I need to fix these connectors as well. So it's lucky that I bought so many packs of those from Fry's, because it's definitely an issue. Let me see if I can get in here and kind of show you what Mick was talking about when he showed how to do the repair. Yeah, here we go. Just give me a second. Sorry about that. But maybe this would help you too. You can't really see. It's hard to get in there. But if you look through the top of this piece right here, you can kind of see, fix that. Yeah, get this focus going. Okay, see how you can see directly through this harness? Wow, somebody needs to cut their fingernail. I just get so dirty working on these things, huh? Alright, so look, if you can see right through those holes there. Okay, there we go. You can see right through those holes. And what kind of Mick is suggesting is you shouldn't be able to, because the spring should be popping up. And if these are hollow up top and you can see right through it, it doesn't sound like these pins are actually touching anything when you slide that in there. So I'm going to take the next step right now. I'm going to strip these down, each one of these wires, and then I'm going to clip it all back in there. Then I'm going to plug it in and see if I get any connectivity or functionality on this board. But maybe before I go through that extent, I should check to see if the power and everything leading to this board is actually working correctly too. So I'm going to do a bunch of things like that, and I'll follow up with you on whatever the solution was for me. But I'm getting really excited that this is not the most complicated fix yet. And thanks to people that make all these awesome videos that show how to repair things and are sharing their knowledge for free, because it's really rewarding to fix things and learn about how synthesizers work. Like, check this out, you know, fix this thing up. Brilliant. You guys know what that is. Now, I cannot wait to hear this thing and this thing together. So hopefully we can get this running soon, and my girlfriend and I can produce some more music on this. And I'm particularly excited for her to have her first like analog synthesizer, as opposed to all these digital ones she's so accustomed to. I really think there's a lot to be said about the warmth and kind of the sloppiness or grittiness that you get from the analog synthesizer. And I'm not trying to get into the digital analog war, because it's pretty much bullshit. And you should know that by now, right? Right? And this is just a cheaper Korg synthesizer. So I intend on like maybe get this thing set up, get this working right. I'm going to make some serious modifications to all the circuitry. All right, everybody. I look forward to figuring this out and giving you guys my solution soon.